Yes, I did.
Yes, I made it.
Yes, I made it.
I'm still here.
I'm still here. Through it all, I'm still here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to stand up in this place today.
Still here. The question is, are you here? Y'all missed that. I'm still here. The question is, are you here? Oh, can we just make a joyful noise? Hallelujah. I'm still here. Good morning to everyone, and to our mothers, as always, and first-time visitors, those who are watching via media, good morning to you all. And a shout-out to our mother, Jessie Mae. Good morning, Mom. And she's smiling from ear to ear, not because I call her name, because one of her sons is at home with her right now. Deacon Vince and Nance, they are in South Carolina with our mother this morning. So, amen. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Well, this morning we're going to look at two passages of scriptures. We're going to Colossians 1, 9 through 13, and then we're going to skip over to Ephesians 4, 17 through 19. Amen? And this is what Paul says. He says, "For this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you, and to desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, unto all patience and long-suffering and joyfulness, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son." And then he says in Ephesians, starting at verse 17, he says, "This I say therefore, and testify in the Lord, that ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their mind, having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their hearts, who being past feeling have given themselves over to lasciviousness, to work all uncleanness and greediness." Hallelujah. And I want to hearken back to the 10th verse where it says, "That ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing." And for a subject this morning, is your walk worthy of the Lord? Amen. Amen. Is your walk worthy of the Lord? The question is, are you worthy this morning walking with the Lord? Does your walk add value to the kingdom? When you woke up this morning, did you do a spiritual evaluation of yourself? Does anyone here needs a spiritual tune-up? Hallelujah. Is sin controlling your life? Have you lost your faith? Has doubt and disbelief taken over your life? Every day we walk with God. Every day our walk with God is tested, and our faith is tested. Our determination and our resolve, they're all tested, and we're challenged every day. And because we are challenged on every side, maybe it has caused you to get out of step with God. But first, let me remind you that all of you can be rejuvenated by simply doing one thing, and that is get back in step with God. But I also need to remind you of who you're getting back in step with. This is what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 1:13-18. He says, "For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over creation. For in him all things were created, and things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him." Yes. He's before all things, and in him things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. So you are getting back in step with Jesus Christ. You are walking with Jesus. You are walking with your Savior, your Redeemer. You are walking with the firstborn, the head of the church. He is the beginning. He is the Alpha. He is the Omega. He is before all things, and in him all things are held together through Jesus Christ. That's who you're walking with. And he is worthy. Amen. He is worthy to be walked with. Amen. Because worthy is the Lamb. I'm talking about Jesus Christ. And Paul is telling the Colossians, he's writing this letter to them to refute the teachings of those who promoted Gnosticism. Gnostics basically only cared about knowledge. They believed that it took special knowledge and not faith to receive salvation. And Paul was trying to refute this heresy by telling the Colossians that it is not what they know that brings salvation, but whom they know. You see, knowing Christ is knowing God. Paul is telling them that he's praying for them, and he heard some good things about their faith and their love for God. And he says in that 9th verse, he said, "For this cause, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his wisdom and all wisdom and spiritual understanding." And then he tells them in that 10th verse to live a life that will honor and please God. And if they do, they will be fruitful, oh hallelujah, in every good work. And he's telling them that if they walk with God, that the fruit that they produce along the way shall be good and shall be bountiful. Yeah, there are benefits in walking with God. And I pray that your walk is not superficial or one filled with hypocrisy. That's what Paul reminds us when he wrote to the Ephesians. He says in that 17th verse, he says, in that first verse, he says, if so, be that ye have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth in Jesus Christ. So he says, you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off the old self, which is being corrupted by deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. So Paul is telling the Ephesians to put off the old man. I love that. He says, let's keep the old man in the grave. Yes. Yeah. That phrase, put off the old man, is a vivid picture of a person taking off their filthy rags of sin and self-righteousness and then burning them. Oh, how many of you have been there where you took off the old man, all the filthy rags, and you just burned them? They do not take them off and hang them in the closet for a rainy day. You can't take them off and put them in the closet for a rainy day, or put them in the closet for the next day. Nor do they toss them on the floor and trip over them on a daily basis. No, when we take off our filthy rags, we are to rid ourselves forever of all the thinking and the bad attitudes and the behavioral things that we do associated with the things that keeps us from experiencing who Jesus Christ is. Oh, can the church say amen? God not only wants to burn the filthy rags on the top, but he wants to burn the undergarment also. Some of us, we just cover certain things up. But on the inside, deep down, there's some things we just don't want to let go of. Yes, yes, there are some hidden things that are not pleasing, some things that you don't want exposed, hallelujah. But Jesus sees everything, and he's telling you to burn them. Yeah, he wants you to burn them, and maybe some of you need to empty out that dark place that's in your closet right now. Oh, hallelujah. Sometimes God does not automatically remove everything from our lives the moment we receive Christ as the personal Savior. We still have to have baggage and bondage left over from our former life, which if we must remove and destroy. It is our responsibility to put these things away. We may not want to acknowledge that we have them clinging on to us, but it's there. And if you don't get rid of it, at some point in time, it's going to make its move on you. We may not even want to walk or talk about them, but eventually we're going to have to face them because we cannot put on the new man and the new person in Jesus Christ while we're holding on to the old man. That's why you've got to be careful glorifying in your former life. Don't get happy, get too happy telling everybody your sinful past when you start glorying in who you used to be. Amen. Yes, use it as a testimony where God brought you from. Yeah. But don't take a step back to go back into how bad you used to be. Oh, hallelujah again. That's why God wants you to burn it. And then he wants you to throw the ashes in the wind and let it scatter. Yeah. Hallelujah again. You see, it's the trick of the enemy to keep you from walking worthy with Jesus Christ. Some of us have old habits we need to break. Some of us have generational curses that we are carrying because we are in denial that it's a stronghold in our lives. But God is telling us to put it off. And if we can only be successful, yes, we can only be successful putting off those thoughts by replacing them with godly thoughts. He says, put off the old man. Then he tells them in the text to walk not as the Gentiles walk in the vanity of their minds. In other words, don't walk like the Gentiles, for they are confused. So I have a question to you. How many of you are walking around confused today? Amen. That's what he said, and that's what Satan wants to do. He wants to bring confusion to and in your life. You as a Christian, and we as a Christian, people should be able to see the difference. Amen. From those who are honest walkers. Those who pretend to be walkers. Yes, yes, God's telling us we can't walk with them. We can't hang with them. If we do, we should be the difference maker in their lives. Yes, you are to live a life of light. Yes, 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 yes. And I want to help somebody right here. We live among and work among non-believers every day. We see ungodliness every day through social media, through television, through family members. We see it all the time, and we know that there's a pull that comes from the flesh every day. But for those of us who are saved and sanctified, Paul is saying that you've got to let the old man go. Leave him behind, leave sin behind. So let the true God comes out of your pores. Let the true Christ come out of your pores every day. You see, living the Christian life is a process. Paul says you've got to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. It's a process. We serve a God who will go with us as we process toward our destination. He's a God of purpose, but he's also a God of process. And while we are walking with him, he has a way of revealing himself to us as we travel along life's highway. You see, God is walking with us right now through the person of Jesus Christ. The question is, are you walking freely with him? That's the question. And I want to drop anchor right here for just a moment. Hallelujah. I want to just pose that question to all married couples right now. Pastor Vita and I, as she said earlier, we're focusing and refocusing on the family this month. I want to take a moment just to talk about marriage for just a little while. Husbands and wives, those who are not walking with God. If you're not walking with God, you're just setting yourself up for a whole lot of trouble. And I know that there are those who desire to be married, and our prayer is that God will send you that deserving husband or that deserving wife at the appropriate time. But in the meantime, I want to talk to the married couples. Are the two of you walking freely with God? That's the question for husbands and wives. Are you walking worthy? Yes, is your walk worthy before God? Yes, husbands and wives, in order for your marriage to be a happy one, in order for your marriage to be successful, the two of you have got to walk together in Christ. Yeah, for the past two Sundays, Pastor Vita and I went back to the book of Genesis and read what God says concerning marriage, that he says it is not good for a man to be alone. And he says in Genesis 2:24, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall what? Become one. Not two, but one. Not three, but one. So God created marriage in the image, a marriage between a man and a woman. And even with the first marriage, Adam and Eve got out of step with God. Everything was all right while they were walking in step with God. There were no fractures in their relationship with God. But the moment they stopped walking with God, sin found its way into the marriage. Yes, it did. That's why husband and wife, you cannot get out of step with God. Because when you do, you become vulnerable to sin. Yes, that the devil pulled on Eve and she sinned, pulled on Adam and he yielded. And it changed the direction of the family. But the marriage stayed intact. I want you to get that. Yes. They had a bump in the road, yes, but the marriage stayed intact. And I want to say to husband and wife, please stay in sync with God's steps. Yes, husband and wives, in order for you to stay in sync, you must march to the same drumbeat, the same heartbeat. Yes. Oh, when two people get married and they step into the marriage boat, she gets an oar, he gets an oar, and Jesus is at the helm beating the drum to keep them in sync at the same time. Yes. Oh, somebody needs to say hallelujah. Yes. Yeah, and as long as they look to Jesus together and listen to every drum beat, they will be happy together as long as they're rowing in the same direction. But the moment that one of them gets out of sync, that's when the devil comes in. You start going in two different directions, or you might go sideways for a little while, but then you don't allow Jesus to be at the center, to come back to the center. And so you get out of step. You're not listening to the drumbeat anymore. So husband and wives, you got, in order for you to walk on water, you got to walk on water looking to Jesus. Yes, yes, yes. I'm going to say it like this. That's what happened to Peter. When Peter was walking, as long as Peter kept his eyes on Jesus, everything was all right. But then the wind got boisterous. The husband and wives, every now and then, the storms are going to come in, boisterous, and it's going to knock you off course for just a little while. And Peter sank because he took his eyes off Jesus. And when you take your eyes off Jesus, you will begin to sink. But the moment he took his eyes off Jesus, Jesus took his hands, raised his hands, and reached down and pulled them up. So what you got to do is keep looking up until that hand comes down and pull you back into step with God. So I'm going to tell those who have issues with pride and those who have big egos, I'm telling you right now, you got to let it go. Don't let the wind, don't let that pride, don't let that ego, don't let the anger, don't let the hatred, don't let the envy and the revenge. Don't let revenge in marriage keep you, and the unforgiveness keep you from walking on water. Yes, there will be some challenges and difficulties that will get to you every now and then. But you keep listening to the drumbeat. And for those, when those difficulties and challenges occur, always ask this question: how can God get the glory? Yes. Oh, I want to say that again. Yes. When you have a disagreement with your spouse, and you are going back and forth with words I don't want to repeat, when you are saying things you shouldn't be saying, you got to ask yourself in the moment, how can God get the glory out of this? Yes. Because if God doesn't get the glory out of this, then you're doing something wrong. Oh, hallelujah again. I want you to think about that. I want you to get it in your spirit, because there will be a disagreement coming up. It's just the nature of who we are. God made man and woman. He didn't make them with the same traits and same personalities. We are different. So things will happen when there will be disagreement. There is a godly way to solve every problem. Question is, are you going to stay in step, or are you going to be out of step? That's the question. When you can use every positive and negative thing that happened in your marriage and point it back to God, your marriage will be blessed. Yes. Hallelujah. If you can point it back to God, your marriage will be blessed. I don't know who God is talking to. If you can point it back to God, your marriage will be blessed. The focus must always be on God when it comes to marriage. Those who are married know that marriage can be difficult at times, but that's part of the process. Walking with God together is part of the process. It's a process where God has provided the ingredients, but he didn't give us all of he didn't give us the recipe to everything that we are facing. The recipe can't be developed, amen, instantaneously. You've got to work together to work out what the recipe is for your marriage. Yes. Amen. God gave us the intent, the purpose, gave us the boundaries, told us about headship and submission. But he didn't tell us specifically, in some instances, how to do it. He didn't give us the recipe with granular instructions. But through the process of time, the hope is that husband and wife will develop their granular instruction based on the Word of God. So that when those mountains come, when the disagreement occur, you will have the recipe to go back to see how God will solve the problem for you. Oh, can God get a hallelujah? Yes. You see, marriage has its challenges and problems and difficulties of living and loving a person every day. But God's intentions for marriage is where the problems are being worked out, where the difficulties are being worked out, where the husband and the wife, they do not split but stick together, face up to their problem, discover where the strongholds are and allow God to remove them. In other words, let God shoulder the burden. Oh, hallelujah. Let God shoulder the struggles. Let God shoulder the issues and the challenges that's going to arise in your marriage. God knows what's best for your marriage because God created marriage. Hallelujah. And he intended for marriage to last as long as the man and woman live together. He intended for marriage to be a commitment. And when you said, I do, there was no turning back. He intended for husbands to love their wives just as Christ loved the church, gave himself up for the church. He intended for the wife to submit to her own husband as to the Lord. He intended for husband to dwell with his wife, respect her, honor her, buy her diamonds, jewelry, homes, buy her vacations. I'm gonna keep talking here. I know the wives are going crazy right now. Buy her all the shoes she wants. Buy her an extra closet. Build her a closet in the attic. Amen. We'll let the wives say amen. I know a whole lot of wives on the other side are saying amen right now. Give them a credit card with no limit. Oh, hallelujah. Oh. We need to cut that one out of the video. Oh, hallelujah. God intended for marriage to succeed. And if the husband and wives are walking worthy together in their commitment to God, God wants husband and wives to walk together in love, not in hate, not in revenge, not in unforgiveness, not in one up, not in who got said the last word. He wants them to walk in what? In love. Love conquers everything. Love is above everything. Everything can be worked through love. That's why God created love. In the midst of the marriage should be love. At the heart of the marriage should be love. Hallelujah. But it's a process. Amen. So are you walking freely with God, husband, wives? Are you walking, is your walk worthy before God, husband, wives? Because if it's not, you are going to have difficulties. Amen. Because God won't be in the midst. So Paul tells the Colossians, Paul said, don't listen to false doctrines, husband, wives. Don't listen to what the world has done and trying to redefine, how they're trying to redefine marriage. Don't listen to people who don't know what they're talking about. Yes. When it comes to marriage, and they're not even married. Never been married. and they're trying to give you advice about being married. Don't listen to that. And to all of you, all of us, don't listen to non-godly advice, but walk worthy of the Lord, and you shall be blessed. Oh, hallelujah again. So my question to everybody, how many of you are walking with God right now? How many of you are walking with Jesus Christ right now? How many of you are walking worthy before Him right now? But let me flip the question and say, how many of you know that Jesus is walking with you right now? If you know that Jesus is walking with you right now, why don't you shout hallelujah? Well, why don't you give God praise for just a second? Because Jesus is walking with you right now. I want you to say amen, because Jesus is walking to you right now. And I want to say to Minister Slayton this week, do you know that Jesus is walking with you right now? Yes, sir, yes, 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 sir. Brother Leon, do you know that God is walking with you right now? Yes, yes, Dr. Common, do you know that God is walking with you right now? Brother Myron, do you know? God is walking with you right now. Let the church say amen. Amen. Well, let's say it again. Amen. Let the church say it. Don't you know the devil doesn't want you to walk worthy before God? He is constantly bombarding you with distractions to keep you off the beaten path. And sometimes you get tired. You get tired of the abuse. You get tired of one bad thing happening after another. You get tired of the doctor visits back and forth. You get tired of the spouse doing the same thing. You get tired that you are running out of money before the month begins. You get tired of the chemo. You get tired of the pressures at work. You get tired of the stress that comes with life. You get tired of trying to eat right, being diabetic. And you say, Lord, I'm trying to walk worthy before you. But I'm tired. I'm trying to keep my faith, but I'm tired. I'm trying to hang in there, but I'm tired. Then God says to you, have you read Isaiah 40 and 31? That's right. That's what God says to you. He says, but for they that wait upon the Lord shall what? Renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So God is saying, my child, I have some wings as eagles that you can mount up on when you get tired. That's what God is talking to somebody right now. In fact, you'll be able to run even though you'll be tired. You won't walk, you won't faint in the process. What you need to understand is that if you are one of those persons who can identify with being tired, then you know that God still has you in His mighty hands. Closed, and you are still closed in your right mind. With all the things that you've been through, Satan tried to take you out, but God was with you. Oh yes, to the choir, I'm still here. I don't know about you, but I'm still here. Satan took his best shot, I am still here. That's a hallelujah moment right there. No, that's a glory to God moment right there, that I'm still here. I want to say something to you right now for somebody. Somebody didn't open up their eyes this morning when it was time to get up. But for those who are in the land of the living, that God woke you up this morning. That's another hallelujah moment right there. David talked about being in the land of the living. And as long as I have breath in my body, I'm going to give God praise when I get up in the morning. Yes, 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 and to realize that God woke you up on this side of the Jordan. And the blessing is one day you will look back over your shoulders and you will see where God brought you from. And you're going to give God praise for where He brought you from. How He walked with you through dangers, seen and unseen. And the same God, that's what you're going to do. You're going to remember what God did for you today. And God is keeping us today. But let's go a little deeper with what Isaiah said. Isaiah celebrates the waiting place, not the destination. But the things that you learn about God is while you wait. Hallelujah. You might be tired, but while you're waiting, you're still walking.
And so we can celebrate the wedding place while we are walking, because we have eagle's wings to fall back on. And even with that security blanket, we won't get tired, nor will we faint. Yes, the wedding place. So don't get so impatient or anxious, because there was a time when God waited on us, when God waited on you. Some of you can testify that you weren't always in step with God. How many times God has waited on you? Waited on you when you were walking with him, and waiting on you when you weren't forgive, and when you were in the streets, waited on you. He could have shut the door on you, but what did God do? He waited. And it was God who showed you grace and mercy. He was the one that picked you up when you stumbled and fell. It was God that kept you throughout the entire time. God did not ignore him, but there were times when we ignore him. So God has waited on you when you weren't walking with him, and now God wants you to wait on somebody else. Will you wait on that child or that family member or that friend who haven't gotten their life together right yet? Hallelujah. Will you still wait on them, pray for them, encourage them, call them every now and then, and let them know that you love them? Yeah. Even though they're not walking right with God, they are still one of child, God's children, and you ought to love them. And so God wants to know, can you wait while they are not walking with him? But for those who can testify that God waited on you, not only is that a hallelujah moment, that's a thank you, Jesus moment. Amen. Amen. For those who are in the sanctuary right now, that's a thank you, Jesus moment. For those who are in the virtual space right now, that's a thank you, Jesus moment. Thank you, God, for not giving up on me. Thank you, God, for healing my body. Thank you, God, for keeping me closed and in my right mind. Thank you, God, that every step that you placed in front of me, even though I didn't take them at first, but I got on track. Thank you, God, for the Holy Spirit directing me, directing my path. Thank you, God. Yes. When you look back over your shoulder again, where he brought you from, the same God that brought you from through your yesterday into your today is going to push you into your tomorrow. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, and when you get to where you're going, that's when you're going to remember that he carried you through the divorce, carried you through the surgery, and carried you through the pain and the hurt. He carried you. Why? Because you're walking with him. Yes, stain you. That's what you will remember. And that's when you won't be able to hold your peace, contain your praise, because of what God did for you. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful every day that God has not only healed my body, but made it whole. Oh, hallelujah. That's a hallelujah moment. Made my body whole. And so for those who can say that I am a living testimony of what God can do, you should be giving God praise for what he's already done. Hallelujah. And all of that occurred because you've been walking with God. Aren't you glad that you're worthy? I'm talking to the worthy folks right now. I'm not talking to the unworthy folks. I'm talking to the worthy folks right now. Are you worthy? Aren't you glad that you're worthy to walk with God? With all the issues that you brought to the table, Jesus still went to the cross for you. And now you are an ambassador for him, proclaiming his name wherever you go and letting others know, if he can do it for me, he can do it for you. And let me help somebody here again. See, God is monitoring you while he's walking with you, and he's teaching you some invaluable life experiences. Now, this is good, because experience teaches patience, and patience hope, and hope making itself not ashamed. For those who are going through right now, God is saying, just lean on me. If you're not there yet, and you don't know how to lean on him, he's saying right now, just lean on me. Because every now and then, you need God to prop you up. Every now and then you need God to stand up in you, because you may not be able to get that text off to somebody. You may not be able to call that best friend. You might not be able to do what you normally do when you need somebody. But Jesus is saying, just lean on me. I am here for you. The Bible says, yes, that he is a very present help. Paul told the Ephesians that they were different now that they were saved. We know that it is the will of God that for all of us to be saved. It is the will of God that we walk in a way that's pleasing and honorable to God. So in Ephesians 4, 17 and 19, he's talking about our walk and the reference to how we should live our lives. The key is your mind. Don't walk like the Gentiles whose minds are concentrated on pointless things. Because if you do, you will walk down a dark path. Yes, and he says in the 19th verse that they have lost their feelings of shame and used their lives to do what is morally wrong. And more they want to do all kinds of evil. Yes, you will go down a dark path. And the thing that you need to understand, you can't walk with God having, amen, a mind being darkened. You can't walk with God when your heart is hardened. You can't walk with God with certain impurities in your heart. That's why I said earlier that you've got to put off the old man. If you are a new creature in Christ, then act like you are a new creature in Christ. Oh, hallelujah. Once you became saved, you should have a desire not to walk the same way. For those who are newly saved, I want to say, amen, that Satan has you on his hit list. In fact, Satan still have all of us who've been saved for a long time on his hit list. And he's trying to find what your weakness, he knows what the weakness is. He's just trying to set you up for that moment when you will stumble and fall. And for those who don't know who he is, that's why you got to put on the full armor of God. I'm starting to say it now. You got to put on the whole armor of God so that when Satan tries his very best, amen, you are covered by the whole armor of God. But Paul is warning us. We cannot walk in the futility of our minds. That is to live an ungodly life before God himself. Because if we do, then we will be totally foreign to God and why Jesus went to the cross for us. So we must walk worthy of the Lord. And as I mentioned earlier, that in the verse, he says that if you walk worthy of the Lord, you shall be fruitful in every good work. In other words, God wants to bless you. Amen. So if you walk worthy before God, God is going to bless you. I hope you get that. That's not hard to figure out. If I don't walk worthy, amen, God is saying, you're not going to be fruitful, that your fruit is not going to be a representation of what I have for you. Amen. It's not that you won't enjoy the comfort of life. You just want to enjoy God's comfort of life on your life. I hope you get that. God wants to bless everything that you touch. And the reason being, so that you can bless somebody else. He wants to give you overflow so that you can give overflow to somebody else. That's what God wants to do. Then he wants to strengthen you with his might, his patience, so that you can endure the trials that will come in life. And because he will, he's going to put a thank you in your spirit. He's going to put a thank you, God, while you're walking worthy of him. And because he will, you're going to be thanking him, married couples, for a great marriage. You're going to be thanking him for healing you in advance. You're going to be thanking him for tomorrow, the thing that's going to happen tomorrow in the days to come. Those who have surgeries to come up, you're going to be thanking him in advance for the healing in advance. That's what God is going to do if you walk worthy before him. He is going to bless you and you will be fruitful in the meantime. That's why I'm so grateful that I'm walking worthy before God. If you are walking worthy before God, then give God praise that you are walking worthy before him. But if you're not, you can't claim that praise. You haven't gotten there. There's some things that you got to get rid of. You got to get rid of the bad habits. You got to get rid of the envy and the strife. You got to get rid of some things in order to walk worthy of God. And finally, I want to ask the question. Isn't it a good feeling to know that you're walking worthy with God? Doesn't it give you the confidence? Amen. Doesn't it give you the confidence that there's nothing too hard for God and there's nothing too hard for you? And so in this pandemic season, let's check ourselves to make sure that we're walking worthy before God. In marriages, let's check ourselves to make sure we're walking worthy before God. So when the enemy comes, he's not going to see us. He's going to see the cross. But you've got to walk worthy before him. When tomorrow comes,
Let's not forget about what God said today. I pray that you take the word forth, amen, so that you walk worthy before him every day, because the enemy is trying his best to see where he can find a crack in your armor. But if you put on the full armor of God, you don't have to worry about that happening, as long as you're walking worthy before God. Can God get a hallelujah? Can Jesus get a hallelujah? I thank you, Jesus. And what I couldn't leave the brothers hanging. I couldn't leave the brothers hanging. I that was a setup for all the wives. And I was just so happy y'all took the bait. Amen. Now to all the brothers. Your wife is going to say yes to everything you say. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Why don't look at your husband strange. Now wife, now wait a minute now. Now he's about to buy you a yacht and everything else. Y'all credit card unlimited. Y'all were doing good there for a second. I just couldn't leave the brothers hanging now. My wife didn't say amen when I said.
Yes, I did.
She yes, I did. She said when I said, you gonna say yes to everything I say?
Yes.
Oh, hallelujah. She did. Yeah. We are in step. Amen. Oh, all the way. The precursor is to all of this is salvation. We can laugh about it, and that's a good thing. But we're headed toward heaven, coming to agreement, knowing that the Word of God can bring us to laughter. But the Word of God also saves. There was a moment in all of our lives when, for those who are saved, we weren't saved. There was a moment when we answered the question, are you saved? And we're so grateful that we did. And that's why we can shout hallelujah. That's why we can walk in victory.